Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here today. Lord, what a blessing it is to come into the house of God. What an honor and a privilege it is to come into this place and to enjoy all the modern amenities and luxuries that we have, things such as air conditioning and lights and music and comfort of seats and things of that nature. Lord, we thank you that these are wonderful things that we get to enjoy and blessings that we get to have to come in to hear your word. But Lord, we know that we don't come for these things. We don't come to hear from a particular preacher or teacher, from the old or from the young, from a man or from a woman. Lord, we come to hear from you. We acknowledge that at this church, it's Jesus Christ, it's the senior leader of this house. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit today would be our teacher, would be our counselor, would lead us and guide us and direct us into your ways and into your truth, Lord, that you would show us today things that we need to know and to understand about our lives so that we might walk out of this auditorium and be your church for your glory. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we ask that you would just bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We fully acknowledge that here in this Inland Empire with over 2 million people in this valley, we know that we cannot reach this Inland Empire all by ourselves. But Lord, we are so grateful that you have strategically placed us here with our brothers and sisters, other churches in this area that proclaim Jesus as Lord to reach this valley for your glory. So Father, we thank you that you would bless them today as you have blessed us. Speak to them as you speak to us, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, praise God. I'm excited for what God's got in store. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, we're continuing our study. We're in a series called Homeland. Now, if you're just joining us, we've been talking about this series, looking at these patriarchs of faith and having an understanding that there's something beyond this life that we live today. And you saw maybe the video announcement where it was like the planet, and it was like Earth is not your home, and kind of, it was kind of cool like that. Discussing the subject of homeland, we're going to continue exactly where we left off last week in Hebrews 11 chapter. Pastor Jim talked to us a couple of great points about how to choose the right homeland. Ultimately, with our lives, the way we live our lives, we are choosing the homeland that we are calling our own. And the thing that Pastor Jim left us off with last week was how to choose the right homeland was to walk like Jesus. To walk like Jesus. And I love that because you think about that. It almost seems when you think about that for a moment, when you just ponder that statement, it almost seems like it's something that's just not possible for you and I to do. I mean, after all, Jesus was the perfect example of God on this earth, a sinless and a spotless life. And so when we think about walking like Jesus, we think, man, I just don't know if I could do that. I mean, I make a lot of mistakes in my life, and I'm sure I'm not the only one that could say that. But I love the fact that God never asks us, God never tells us, and God never directs us to do something that he has not equipped us to do through his grace and through his power. And praise God, because of his grace, we have the ability to walk like Jesus, which means we can. We can walk like Jesus. And it's exactly that phrase, that idea, that statement, that sentiment that I want to continue in as we study and as we look at today's topic. And the title of this message today is Walk the Walk. To walk the walk, to live out our lives, the walk that we're talking about today. And so I want to look at Hebrews 11 chapter. Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 14 is where we want to focus in today. The Bible tells us, it says that those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Now, we're talking about the patriarchs of faith operating in life through faith. Everything we do in life is a faith journey. We learned this in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. It says that without faith, it is impossible to please God, which means every day, every moment of our lives, we have to walk and step and operate in faith. And the whole subject, the whole context of what we're talking about is these patriarchs, these people who have gone before us and have lived an exemplary life of faith. Now, it's talking about those who declare or those who say such things. The verse, the previous verse, verse number 13, tells us that there are those of those who have gone before us who have heard the promises of God, who had been given a promise by God, but yet they did not see it come to pass in their lifetimes. But the Bible says that they continued to confess their promise. They embraced their promise and they lived their life in faith because they knew that God had something better for them. So it's talking about these people who confessed, who embraced, who lived and operated in faith. It says they say and declare. Those who say and declare. Those words, say and declare, begin to bring a picture to our mind. A picture that we're familiar with if you've ever been in church for any amount of time. A picture of confession. The confession mentality to begin to speak what God says, to start saying those confessions. And that's so important. It's a very integral part of our life to continue to say and declare what God has for us, but I want to bring us to a thought. Is there something more to life than just confession? And the reason I say that is, you know, a couple of years ago in the 90s and in the early 2000s, there was a big move with a certain group of preachers, and we were in school at the time at Bible College in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Tulsa, Oklahoma is the buckle of the Bible Belt. Now, they call the Midwest the Bible Belt because there's churches everywhere in the Midwest, and then they call Tulsa the buckle. I mean, like every corner is a mega church in some form or fashion. They're all over the place, and it's really cool. And I remember as we were in Bible College, we were learning this mentality, and there was this kind of fun jest, and we were having a good time with it. And so we came up with all these different slogans that preachers were using all the time. They were talking about things like, you got to name it and proclaim it. Amen. You got to blab it and grab it. I'm going to name that promise, and I'm going to claim it in Jesus' name. I'm going to blab it in Jesus' name. I need that house, and I'm going to blab it, and then I'm going to grab it. And I'm going to confess it, and I'm going to say it, and I'm going to speak it, and I'm going to keep going, and my life is going to be about confession, and that's great, and that's wonderful, and I don't want to belittle that because I believe we have to confess God's promises over our life. The Bible tells us right there that they did that. But I think that there's something a little bit more than just words. And the reason I say that is I remember while we were in Bible College, we had assigned seating. And there was this one particular semester where I sat next to this lady. I didn't know her, but every morning it was the same routine. We'd get together and we'd sit in our seat, and I'd look over to her and I'd say, how are you doing this morning? And she would say to me, I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Amen. That's good. I like that. The next day I'd come and I'd see her in class. How are you doing this morning? I'm blessed and I'm highly favored of the Lord. Praise God. Next week would go by. I'd see her. Good morning to you. How are you doing this morning? I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Cool, right on. A couple weeks go by, see her again. How are you doing this morning? I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord. All right, cool, whatever. Now see, I understand what she was doing. And I don't want to make light of that. She was confessing what the Bible says, that she was blessed and highly favored of the Lord. And that's great, and we need to do that. But you see, as time progressed, I began to notice something in this relationship that her and I were building and developing together. Never once in our conversations, which were brief, did she ever respond back to me, I'm blessed and highly favored the Lord. How are you? Never once did she deviate from her comment or say anything else. It was always, I'm blessed and highly favored the Lord. Which after the course of a couple of weeks of interacting with her, I began to not need to ask her. I would sit next to her and kind of look at her. I didn't need to ask you how you were doing because I knew you were blessed and highly favored of the Lord. It's like calling an automated machine. I could just look at her and blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Thank you, click. See, what happened is, even though she was confessing, even though she was saying and she was declaring, after the course of some time, it began to feel very hollow, very, very ungenuine. She wasn't reflecting, she wasn't acting, she wasn't showing anything in her life to emphasize or to put into value or placement that which she was saying. It was always blessed and highly favored of the Lord, and that was the end of the conversation for the day. And every once in a while, every couple of weeks, go by and I wouldn't talk to her, I wouldn't ask her, and I'd kind of look over and be like, how you doing? Blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Ah, I know that. See, sometimes what happens to us is we get wrapped up in a lot of talk. We get wrapped up in talk all of our lives. Well, I'm going to do this. I went to church this today, and the preacher, hallelujah, he told me that I am blessed and highly favored of the Lord. And so I'm going to walk out there, and I'm going to tell everybody I know, I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord. But talk only gets us so far in life. And so when we look at these words, and we say and declare, there's something I think that there was a little bit more to that we're missing out in our lives. And as I began to study this and I was praying, God, where do you want me to go with this message? Where do you want me to take in this verse? I began to read this. I have this really cool program that has a Greek Bible. And I have no clue what it says because I don't read Greek. But thank the Lord that underneath the Greek Bible, it has the English equivalent. Now, it doesn't make the sense that we read it because Greek is kind of like Spanish to English, like, you know, Casablanca, not Blasa, Blanca Casa, like we would say, right? All right, that was gringo words. But as I looked it up, this word, declare, it's the Greek word that we get the word emphasize from, to emphasize something. But the word declare in the Greek literally means to make known. Okay, we know that declare. How about this? To reveal. I like this one. To show. To show. As a matter of fact, the New International Version helps to specify this and to clarify this. It says in the New International Version, it says, the people who say such things, their confessions of their faith, show that they are looking for a country of their own. You see, we're talking about this subject of walking this walk. And you see, when it comes to walking like Jesus, it's not about talking and then walking. There's something we have to do in order to be like Jesus, and that is to walk like Jesus, not just talk like Jesus, because talk will only take you so far. You know, we come and we hear these inspirational words and these motivational stories, and the preacher does a really good job and he works really hard. Veins start popping out of his neck right here, and he tries to keep you awake as hard as he can to inspire and to motivate you so that when you walk out of service, you say, bless God, I got something. But you know, inspiration and motivation will only take you so far if you don't do anything with it. Last year we were reading some, my wife and I, we were seeing in the articles and the news and blogs and all over social media. It was a real big trend around October of last year. We got inspired. There was an inspiration on us and we looked at it. There was this whole movement called cutting the cord. Anybody know what I mean when I say cutting the cord? It means that we realized that we were paying so much money for cable TV. We had thousands of television channels that we were never watching. And we realized, you know, I don't need this in my life. And so people all over the nation were removing cable TV from their lives. And so we got inspired. We got motivated. We said, what are we going to do without TV? Man, what they did before they had TV. What was that? Read a book? But as long as it has pictures, I'm okay. And we got really motivated. Man, we're going to do this. We decided in October of 2014, we're going to cut the cord. Praise God. You know what? It's cool to say, a year later, I have yet to call my cable company and notify them that I decided to cut the cord. You see, you can make decisions. You can find inspiration all you want, but if you're not doing anything with that inspiration, nothing ever comes from that inspiration and motivation. I can confess that I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord all day long. I can confess in my life and declare and proclaim all the different promises of God in my life all day long, but words will only take me so far because there's this old statement, actions speak louder than words. As a matter of fact, a couple of guys in our church got together to help emphasize that exact statement. Check it out.
You don't understand, man. I woke up today, dude, and I was just feeling it. Like, I felt it. I was like, I woke up, and right away, I was like, boom, workout day today. Revelation. Today is the day I'm going to get swole. I'm going to get buff. I'm going to get ripped. I'm going to look like Arnold. I'm going to look like Arnold. That's me, dude. I was ready. I was like, okay, I pumped in some protein, you know, some pre-protein. Had a Krispy Kreme in between for energy. Dude, I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it right now. Okay?
Let's
Can we do
it.
This?
Let's do
Let's
it.
Do this. Are you ready?
Let's go.
Are you ready? Let's go.
Let's go.
No, I'm thinking I could probably pump out at least like 100 of these things. I mean, it can't be that hard, you know what I mean? It's like hundreds. Sturdy. I'll tell you about this. Hashtag working out. Hashtag 100, hashtag easy, hashtag getting swole. Oh, Justin messaged us. Justin messaged us. Oh, he's at the gym too right now. Yeah, I am so feeling the burn, bro. Yeah, he knows what we're talking about. Leg. Dude, he's doing a leg day. Legs? That doesn't even do anything. I never work out legs. Like, what's the point? That's dumb. I can't really talk right now. I'm working out. No, I'm in the middle of working out right now. What do you... Yeah. Yes. Yes, I'm working hard. It's good. No, yeah, I'm doing good. I'm trying to meet my goals. Remember the goals I said at the beginning of the year? Yeah, I'm doing it. I can't talk right now. I'm trying to work, okay? You're ruining my groove. The entire zone I was in is shattered. Gone. Come on, like, seriously, like... How am I ever supposed to meet my goals? Okay. Yes, thank you. All right, I love you too. I love you more. Okay, bye. Oh, man. You know, man, the one thing I love more than working out is talking about working out.
So we understand, we get it. We can talk all we want about doing something. But if something doesn't come from inside of that talk, if something greater doesn't happen from just saying something, then nothing ever happens from it. Brad will never look like Curtis if he doesn't get off the phone and start doing what he needs to do. You see, that takes us to this place. We say, okay, Pastor Luke, I know where you're going. I know where you're going with this. You're saying, you know what? Okay, I don't want to just talk like Jesus. I got to start acting like Jesus. Amen. Praise God. That's great. But I don't want to just take you to acting. Why? Because actors are good at acting. Actors are good at acting. They take a role that's not them and they put it on them. They get into the persona and they act it out. But when they're alone, when they're in their private, when they're no longer in front of anybody else, they become who they are. And it's not just about acting. Because, you know, honestly, actors are good at acting, but I'll say Christians. I'll even take it a little step further than that. I'll just call them churchgoers. Churchgoers are really good at acting. Man, some of the people who go to church are putting on Oscar-worthy performances in their lives. They come to church, and when they're around the people that they know that they need to act out or they need to show something, oh, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. And I'm proclaiming, and I'm professing, and I'm confessing. But when they're alone, when they're in their private time, or when they're around people that they don't need to act out anymore, the real person comes out. Because you see, it's not just about saying, and it's not just about going out there and doing something. Why? Because we can get wrapped up in deeds and works. And deeds and works are great, and our world needs good works, and our world needs good deeds. But you can do good deeds and good works without Jesus. That's evidenced by men like Socrates and men like Thomas Jefferson, who took all of the miracles and the miraculous things of Jesus and took all of those out and just put all of the good words that Jesus said. Men like Gandhi, who said, I love your Christ, but I don't like your Christians. You see, we can have a world full of good works, but that's not exactly walking the walk. Because there's something more than just talking and doing. There's something more that carries us throughout this life than just saying something about myself and then just trying to do it the best I can. Because when you look back at the book of Hebrews and the whole content of the 11th chapter is the subject of faith and the people who lived their life in faith and changed their world around them because they operated in faith. When we look at things like the New Testament and the book of Acts and the disciples and the apostles and these people that heard the word of Jesus and we saw that they turned their world upside down, we realized that there was something bigger in their life than just words and actions. There was something greater inside of them. And today I want to take a look at that and I want to take you there and I want to just tell you the end in the beginning. Can I just do that so that way you can stick with me the entire time? Can I just give you the end? It's like the tagline for the entire message. Here it is. So don't tune me out because I'm going to explain it. We're going to go through a journey together. The whole emphasis is this when we walk like Jesus. Is when you know who you are, you know why you're here. And when you know why you're here, you'll know what to do. Because you have purpose. Because ultimately, every person in this auditorium, every person outside of this auditorium, every person on the freeway, every person at a job, every person at home, whether you're a mother with kids or a business person or a professional, every person in life wants to have purpose, a reason to live. And when we think about this and when we gather upon this, this is what people are seeking after all of their lives, is a reason to exist, something that is deep on the inside of them, and it goes so much deeper than just words and just acting on something. And these men who changed the world had an understanding of who they were. Therefore, they knew why they were here. And because they knew why they were here, they knew what they were supposed to do while they were here. And today I want to take you to that and show you that. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Acts. Acts in the 3rd chapter. I want to show you a really cool story in the Bible of some of these men, these patriarchs of faith, these men that we study and we look to them and we look at this as them in examples. Acts in the 3rd chapter. There's two men we're going to talk about here. Peter and John. Peter and John are two disciples of Jesus. And they walk and they're going to this place, to the temple, and they go through this place and a gate. They called it beautiful, so it's called the Beautiful Gate. And the reason it was called the Beautiful Gate, it was this great bronze gate that had beautiful inscriptions and carvings, and it was gorgeous. And the floor of the entryway there was covered in marble, and they had this great kind of balcony type trellis there, and they called it Solomon's Portico. And it was this beautiful, elegant place, and they were walking through this gate that they called beautiful to go to the temple. The Bible tells us that in the story that there was a man, later on we find through this man's life, that he was 40 years old. And that from the time of his birth, his family, his parents, his friends, whoever he could get, would bring him to this gate, drop him off at this gate so that he could beg for money because he was crippled from birth. He could not walk. His legs were not functioning. So there they would put him at this gate. There for 40 years of his life, every day he begged. Every day he asked for alms. He asked for support. Every day this man sat on the outside of the temple looking in to everybody going through, passing through this gate, hoping that he might get some sympathy for them. And then one day comes along and Peter and John pass this man. And he asks them for alms. He asks them for money. In verse number 6, it says, Peter says, "Silver and gold I do not have." I don't have what you're asking for. Now, some might say, well, Peter had it because, you know, Jesus had a treasurer. The Bible tells us that in the book of Acts, they took all of their possessions and shared them together so nobody lacked anything. Peter was telling this man, what you're asking for, I don't have. But I love what Peter says. But what I do have, I give to you. Something bigger. Something more than just words. Something more than somebody who just taught them and inspired them and motivated these men. They had something greater than just motivation and inspiration. Peter says, I don't have what you're asking for, but what I have what you need. And he says, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise and walk. The Bible tells us in the next verse, and he took him by the right hand and he lifted him up, and immediately, I love this, immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. So cool. A miracle right before their eyes. So he, verse number 8, leaping up, stood up and walked and entered the temple with them. Walking and leaping and praising God. For 40 years, this man stood on the outside, sat on the outside. For 40 years, through the power of somebody else helping him and leaving him there and letting him there to beg and to ask for alms, he sat on the outside of this beautiful gate. But now, because Jesus, or because Peter said, I don't have what you're asking for, I have what you need. Now all of a sudden, this man, for the first time, walks through the gate that he stood on the outside into the temple, praising and leaping for God. You see, these men, they had something on the inside of them. Something so deep, so profound in their lives that they couldn't just hold on to it. It literally emanated. It shined out of them that no matter where they went, the Bible tells us that people would be healed when Peter's shadow crossed over them. Why? Because it was something so great in their lives that they couldn't contain it. Because it wasn't just words and motivation and inspiration, and it wasn't just acting out in what somebody told them to do. They had something deeper in their lives than just words and actions. They knew who they were. And that because they knew who they knew why they were here right then. And because they knew why they were there, they knew exactly what they were there to do. And it gave them purpose in life, and there was something more. I love it in the chapter over. If you got your Bibles, go to chapter number 4. Now they're there. Peter afterwards preaches Jesus. And everybody's listening to Peter's message. And the Sanhedrin, the religious leadership, the religious elders, they kind of get upset because Peter is preaching Jesus whom they crucified. So they pull him in and they begin to question Peter. And in verse number 13 of chapter number 4, it says, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men." Think about that for a moment. They perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. You see, in this time, in this day, in this age, you went through school, you went through education till about the age of 12. And about the age of 12, you selected a rabbi to lead under, to be a protege of. And if that rabbi chose you, then you would continue to go on in your education, to learn, to read, and to write, and to copy down, and to become a rabbi yourself. But if you did not get chosen for that, then you were brought into the workforce, and you went into an apprenticeship. You went into the working force, and these men, Peter and John, followed their father's footsteps, and they went into fishing. They were simple men. The Bible tells us in the New International Version, they perceived that they were untrained and ordinary men. Sounds a lot like you and me. What do I have that's special to offer to this world? Nothing. But Peter says, it's not what I have. It's not what you're asking for. I've got something deeper than just me. It's not about my education. It's not about how good I look. It's not about how well and eloquently I speak. He says, I've got something. And the thing that I've got, you can have. And these men marveled because these uneducated, these untrained, these ordinary, these simple men were so profound in their speaking, were so profound in their knowledge. And it says that they realized they had been with Jesus. It wasn't just what he said. It wasn't just trying to do what he did in action. They had been with Jesus. And I love how we always usually stop there, because that's great. We clap on that. It's just inspiring. It's motivating. But I love what the next verse 14 says. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. Do you remember Hebrews 11:14, those who say such things show. You see, Peter was preaching Jesus. Peter just said, I don't have what you're asking for, but what I do have is what you need, and you can have him too. And so he shows through Jesus Christ and through the power of God that Jesus is the answer to the life's issues that we have. And there, as they're making their defense before the council, they realize, because there's somebody there showing their life, they couldn't say anything against it. See, they couldn't argue it. They couldn't defend it. They couldn't go in. They couldn't take it away, because it became so real to them. It was so deep in them. It was so eminent inside of them. It was so profound on the inside of them that no matter what anybody said, no matter what anybody did, nobody could take away what they had, because they knew it was real. And they recognized and they realized they were part of something bigger in this life. You're part of something bigger. You're part of something greater. You see, this life that you live is not just about you. This life that I live is not just about me. This life that we live is about Jesus. That's why we're here. You see, when you know who you are, you know why you're here. And when you know why you're here, you know what to do. You and I are here because of Jesus. They had an understanding of who they were. And despite the fact that these men were from all different walks of life, some of them were Jewish, some of them were Greek, some of them were Roman, some of them were from African descent, Ethiopian and Egyptian, no matter where they were, no matter who they were, they realized that it wasn't where they came from that defined who they were. They recognized that this life wasn't about who they once were. This life was about who they were serving and where they were going, Jesus. They had an understanding. The fathers of faith in Hebrews 11 chapter had an understanding that this life is a journey for God. Peter tells us, we were there last week. Peter tells us, he says, he recognizes that this life, we're travelers. Paul says that this life that we live, we're living in tents. It's a temporary structure. James tells us that this life, this time that we live here on earth, is vapor. It's temporary, it's a flash, and then it's gone. They all had the understanding together that they were just a part of something bigger. And it wasn't about them. It was about Jesus. For you and I today, it's not about you. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. Because we got to understand who we are before we can even understand what we're here for. And who we are because of Jesus Christ is exactly the same as who they are. We are citizens of heaven. Citizens of heaven. They had many nationalities, many different beliefs. But Paul says, I'm not even any longer. It's not me anymore. He says, it's not about me being a Jew from the tribe of Benjamin. It's not me rising up and being a protege of Gamaliel. It's not me being a Pharisee. It's not about that, because it's not where I came from that defines who I am. He says, it's where I'm going, my homeland, my fatherland, my nation. I am a citizen of heaven. That is what defines who I am. Ephesians tells us in the book of Ephesians in the second chapter, we'll just put it up on the overhead. Paul says, therefore, you're no longer strangers. You're no longer strangers and foreigners, outsiders looking in like that man on the outside of that temple gate, watching everybody else go in and come out. He says, now you are fellow citizens with the saints. Fellow citizens. Your citizenship may not necessarily be the nationality from which you come. Your citizenship now with Jesus Christ is the citizenship of heaven. And it is built upon, and members of the household called of God, built upon the apostles. Show the next verse. The foundation of the apostles and the prophets, the men who understood their life was not about them. It wasn't about their agenda. It wasn't about their words, their ideals, their thoughts about how much they could get and how much they could gather. It was about Jesus. I remember when we were in Bible college, since I was using Bible college illustrations, my good friend Pastor Joe's on the front row, and he's thinking, oh no, what are you going to do? Shaking his head at me. I remember when we were driving, Pastor Joe, he had this car, and in this car, he was really proud of his heritage. He was Puerto Rican, right? We always mess around like that. And he had this flag that he would hang from his windshield rearview mirror. So that everywhere he went, every time he looked in his rearview mirror, everywhere he parked and anybody looked into his car, they knew that a Puerto Rican was in that car. Because he was proud of his heritage. Because he was proud of where he came from. That's who he was. Today, you might be Mexican. You might be German or Filipino, or of Asian descent, or of African descent, or European descent, or South American descent. But you see, it's not about where you came from that defines you. You are not defined by your nationality. Now you and I are defined by our citizenship, and that is our citizenship of heaven. That's why Paul says, there's no slave, no free. There's not a Jew or a Greek. We are all one body in the body of Christ. Why? It's not about black or Mexican or white and promoting our agendas and our tribe and our ancestry. It's about promoting our citizenship. That is the citizenship of heaven in which we belong. That is who you are. And you see, they had a bigger understanding that it wasn't just about their words. It wasn't just about their actions. It was about their identity. And they understood exactly who they were. And when they knew who they were, they knew why they existed. They had purpose in their life. And because they had purpose, now because of that purpose, they knew what to do with their lives. You see, we have purpose in our lives. Our purpose is not only are we citizens of heaven, but we are also ambassadors of heaven. Representatives of Jesus Christ, which means everywhere you go, everywhere I go, it's not about words, it's not about acting, it's about representing Jesus Christ to the world. They had an understanding, these men who changed the world. They didn't have a Bible to thump on. They didn't have blogs and books to read. They had the words of Jesus that they had heard first or second or third hand, and with that they took it and they changed the world, because they understood that everything they did in life was a representation to somebody else about Jesus, about heaven. And when we have that understanding that we are ambassadors, Paul says in 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, you are ambassadors for Christ. When we realize and when we recognize that we represent Jesus, when we show off the world that we are a member of the body of Christ and that we are seeking a homeland by showing it with our lives, we are representing the kingdom of heaven. You see, an ambassador, they don't promote their own agenda. Wherever they are abroad, they promote the agenda of their homeland. Why? Because they are representing their homeland, which means our purpose is to live, to understand who we are, and our purpose is to represent, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in all forms and fashions, not just with our words.
Amen, amen.
I remember there was a time when I was playing hockey. I've used the example before. And I was playing on a hockey team, and everybody knew that at the time I was a young adults pastor, so everybody knew that I was a pastor, and so I got this nickname. Everybody gave everybody nicknames, and so I got this nickname on my hockey team, Rev. Everybody called me Rev. And so there, as I was playing one time, I remember I was skating hard for the puck up in the offensive zone, and a man tripped me. The guy behind me tripped me, and I fell. And then when I fell, my legs went out, and I tripped him, and he fell on top of me, and it hurt. So I got up, and I was real upset, and I was real mad, and I was flailing around, and I got up, and I saw the referee and called a penalty, and I thought, yes, that's right. And then he pointed at me, and he called me for tripping, and I lost. All the high school words came out. All that old man, that dead man whom I proclaim to be dead, came out in me again, and I was ready to fulfill what you have the expectation to see when you go to a hockey game. I was ready to throw down. And just like you see in a hockey game, when the referee had me by the arm and he was dragging me to the penalty box and I'm skating away trying to get to that guy that tripped me, I went skated past my bench, my team members. Now you would think they would be like, yeah, man, tear his face off, go for it, we're going to get you. But as I was skating by, they were all to their feet shouting and yelling at me. And they were all saying, hey, stop, dude. That's not you. This isn't who you are. That's not the person we know. They knew who I was, even though in that moment I had forgotten. Because you see, we're representatives of Jesus Christ everywhere we go. And I'm so blessed to say that even though I had a poor example that night, there was a friend on that hockey team whom I helped lead to the Lord because of that representation. How cool is that? Paul the Apostle says in Philippians, the first chapter, I'll put it up in the New Living Translation, he says, above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, to conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Jesus. To live as citizens of heaven, to conduct yourselves. But you see, it's not about acting. It's not about looking the part. He says, don't conduct yourselves in a manner that's worthy because you have this thinking or this process or this type of ideology about God that he's like Santa Claus looking over your shoulder, making sure who's naughty and nice. We don't live conducting ourselves according worthy of the gospel because we're afraid of judgment. We do so because we have the understanding of who we are. I'm a citizen of heaven. I know who I am because I know who I am. I know why I'm here. Why am I here? To be an ambassador to Jesus because I know why I'm here. I know what to do. What is that? To live a life that conducts myself worthy to represent Jesus. Wherever we go, we take this ambassadorship, this representation with us. Now, I had something with me. I don't know where it is. Everywhere you go, when you travel, you have this little book you take with you. It's called a passport. Oh, it's in my pocket. Thank you. Are awesome. My wife told me, she's like, it's in your pocket. Amen. Whenever you travel, you have to take one of these. Whenever you leave the country. Why? Because your country is your nationality. These are your certification, your documents. It's proof, evidence that you are a resident, a citizen. I remember a while back, my wife and I, we went traveling and we went to Canada, our neighbors. It was great. We spent a couple of days there and we were hanging out. It was so much fun. And we had to show our papers, our document, our certification while we were there. But you know what happened? We lost these. Oh no, pretty bad. Thank the Lord we found them. But you see, we understand that whenever we travel, whenever we leave our homeland, we have to carry evidence of who we are with us. But as Peter says, we're travelers. As Paul says that we live in tents. This is vapor time. We are traveling in this life, which means everywhere we go, we have to carry our certification, our documents, our proof, our evidence of who we are. And that evidence for you and me is the Holy Spirit dwelling on the inside of us. He's our certification, our stamp of originality, saying, I have claimed you. You're no longer an outsider. You have proof and evidence that you are a citizen of heaven because I am on the inside of you. But you can't travel without it, which means we can't go throughout life without it. We have to show it, to exemplify it, to live it, to walk it. Because to walk like Jesus, church, ultimately, is to imitate Jesus. Do you remember when you were kids, you went to school, Remember you had that time, it was called show and tell, it was so exciting, you got to bring whatever that was special to you to school, and then you got to tell everybody why it was special to you, show and tell. Jesus exemplified tell and show. He didn't just tell us, he showed us. He didn't just say, there's no greater love than this, than to lay your life down for somebody that you love, for a friend. He showed it. He didn't just say, love one another. He showed it. He didn't just tell us to pray lest you enter into temptation. He showed it. He exemplified it. He became a walking, living example of the lives that you and I are to walk out in this time, this tent, this journey. Because Jesus understood in the 33 years that he lived on this earth that this was a temporary time. And he said, I must be about my Father's business. He says, my food is the word of God, and I sustain myself on God's desire and God's plan for my life, because he understood that this time he was living was a vapor time here on earth. And then he said to you and I, follow me. To follow me. To have that understanding that because of me, you are no longer outsiders like that man at the temple gates, but you have been lifted up, because what we have now, we have Jesus. And now we can come in and we are no longer outsiders. We are citizens of heaven. Because we know who we are, we know why we're here. Why are we here? We realize that we are ambassadors to Jesus in every aspect, in every area of our lives, whether you're in the business field or you're a mother at home or you're retired. It doesn't matter where you are in life. Whatever you do, you are a representative of Jesus Christ in the kingdom of heaven in your life. And because of that, we realize that we know what to do. We have a purpose to live, to follow, to imitate Jesus, not just in word or in deed, but in life. Because Paul the Apostle says these words. He says that the life that I live, I no longer live for me, because he says, I count myself as dead. He says, I now live through Jesus Christ, faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul understood, my life is a living, walking, breathing example of Jesus. And although I may not be perfect, although I might make mistakes in my life's desire, my purpose here is to imitate Jesus. And he encourages you and I, the church. Church, imitate me, Paul says, as I imitate Christ. That's why we have things like Hebrews 11th chapter. Because we learn that they lived their life in faith. And we see that these men who didn't have a Bible, these men who didn't have the apps and the information that we have available to us today in our fingertips, yet despite all of that, they had something on the inside of them that was bigger. They realized that their identity was not about them. Their identity was that they are now citizens of heaven. These ordinary and simple and untrained men were now something special in the eyes of God. Citizens of heaven. Ambassadors and representatives of Jesus Christ, to say that I don't have what you're asking for, but I have what you need, and you can have it. In a society today that tries to skirt hard work, to find any shortcut that we can to get to the end result as fast and as quick and as conveniently as we can, we've got to understand that we cannot just talk the talk. We cannot just act the part and die on the inside. But God has called us to walk the walk like Jesus, to understand our identity in Christ, that we are so much more than actors. We are so much more than confessors. We are literally ambassadors to the kingdom of heaven. And you might say, Pastor Luke, that's so great, that's so wonderful. I understand the message, exactly what you're talking about, and it's for the person next to me, because I've been in this all of my life. Every day we wake up is an opportunity for us. To walk in faith, to talk in faith, or to act. Today, don't get up and just talk. Don't let yourself get in the way of what God wants to do by just talking and talking and talking. Because despite how old you are or how young you are, despite what profession you are or what you aren't, we can get wrapped up in talk and not go anywhere. But you see, God's desire for us is to walk this walk. If you're walking or you're believing or you're talking about your healing, begin to walk every day in your healing. If you're believing and if you're professing and you're confessing for restoration in your marriage, begin to walk how God would have you to walk, how Jesus would walk, to love, to exemplify what the love of Jesus Christ means in a broken relationship. If you're at work waiting, God, I'm waiting on my promise. I'm waiting on my raise. I'm waiting on you to move me out of this place because these people don't like me. Begin to walk your life out how Jesus would have walked despite people liking you or not every day. It's a choice to either talk about it or do something about it. And Jesus said these words to his disciples and to you and I, greater things than I did, you will do. Because I go to my Father. Yes, there are 2 billion people on this earth that profess to follow Jesus. What would this world look like if all 2 billion of us followers imitated Jesus in our walk? Now, we may not be able to go and reach and tell every person on earth who professes to follow Jesus, but there's something that we can do. We can start with us. You can start with you. We can start with me. Not just talking this talk. Not just acting the part and coming to church and playing the game. But walking the walk, because there's something greater and deeper and bigger on the inside of us to realize that this life is not about me. This life is about Jesus. And if we want the results that Jesus had, we'll have to do what Jesus did. And that doesn't come by words or by trying to look the part. It comes by walking the part. Because those who say such things show with their lives. You are part of something far greater than you can imagine about yourself. You are a part of the kingdom of heaven. And when you know who you are and you have an understanding of your identity, like those men before us, that our life is built upon the foundation of their words and their teaching and their lives. Like the men before us, they understood who they were. They knew why they existed. Now you have a purpose in your life. And because you have a purpose, you now have you know what to do. You have a direction to follow, to imitate, to act out, to live and to walk like Jesus. That's when this world will really begin to change. And it starts with us in our lives. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. Now listen, before we finish today, I want to give you the opportunity. Don't leave, don't get up. Just give me more attention moment, more of your attention. And I just want to talk to you for a moment. The reason is I don't know everybody in this place. I don't know who you are. I don't know where you walk or where your walk is with God. And I wouldn't want to leave under the pretenses or the assumptions that everything's okay, because ultimately we come into this house with a lot of assumptions and a lot of pretenses, and heaven forbid we do that and we leave not knowing and not being sure. The Bible tells us that we have to examine ourselves and to judge ourselves there oftentimes, to look into our hearts and to be open and to be honest with where we stand with God. And if you were to look into your heart right now and to be open and to be honest, especially given the subject that we talk about today of walking that walk, to examine your life and your position with God, How is it your stance is with God? You know, sometimes we look at our life, we look at our stance, we look at our position, you say, you know what, I think everything's okay with God. I think I'm doing good. But just because you think that everything's okay, because you hope everything's okay, because you want everything to be okay, doesn't mean that it's it. You know, there's been times in my life when I've made mistakes and I've done things that are wrong, and I thought everything was good between me and my wife because of this subject, but I didn't know that in her eyes things were not good and things needed to be fixed. Just because you think, because you hope, because you want to, doesn't mean that you're going to be right with God and find yourself in heaven in eternity, seeking that homeland like we talked about today. So often what happens is we come into this place and we believe that because we were raised in church, or my parents took me to church, or I was baptized, or I was christened as a baby, my parents told me that as I was growing up, I was a Christian. That means I'm going to go to heaven. That means I'm right with God, because Christians are right with God. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church, that because you were christened as a baby or baptized as a child, because your parents gave you a title or a label growing up, that means that you're okay with God. You know, I was just watching a TV show this last week, and some people were getting baptized, that they were older in their age, and their friends who had been baptized were younger, and they were saying, I can't believe they waited so long, and they were talking about how they were good with God, yet they were on their way to this baptism drinking and smoking and talking all sorts of terrible things. How deceived we are in thinking that all I have to do is get dunked in some water, sit in a church service, listen to some inspirational and motivational words, and think that everything in my life is okay, when in the truth of the matter, all I'm doing is speaking or acting, and inside I'm dying. You can't just come to church and think that because you sit in a service, hear the pastor, preacher, get baptized, that means that everything's good with you and God. You can't find that in God's word. So often what we think is, you know, I'm a good person. As a matter of fact, my friend Pastor Joe a couple of weeks ago was talking to a young lady, asking her about the very subject of where do you stand with God? And she says, you know, I figure in my life that if I do good and I be good, it's all good. And in that conversation, she concluded with the words, that's my belief. So as to say, stop talking, we're done. You know, I would like to think that that's the way to do it. I would like to think that if I'm a good person, if I have good actions, if I live a good and an exemplary life, that everything's good. But like we talked about today, we can have good works aside from God. Because the Bible tells us, you know what, your good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. It's not about how good you look. It's not about how good you act, the deeds that you do. There's something greater, something deeper on the inside of us that needs to be connected to God. And the only way we can have that connection, that unification to God, to be accepted and to be in right standing and to find ourselves in heaven with that homeland that we so desire to be, is God's way. You see, you can't get to heaven your way. You can't get to heaven some well-meaning author or committee's way. There's so many books on how you and I can find God. But the only way we can get to God is through Jesus. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. It's not about your confession. It's not about your words. It's not about your acting. It's about Jesus. Those disciples, they had something greater. Jesus, Peter says, but what I have, I give to you, Jesus Christ. And it's not about this mental ascent of who Jesus is. Well, I know about Jesus. That's not having Jesus, knowing Jesus. Jesus says these words in the book of John, third chapter, to a religious leader. He says, in order to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Born again, you think of those words, you think of what Hollywood and society's made it out to be. We've had sitcoms about it. Internet has all sorts of articles about that, those crazy, weirdo, out of control Christians. But born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing to his heart. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his son, Jesus. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his church, to you and I. And he says these words. He says, I'd rather find that you're hot, or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. And it's a shocking statement. And you see the background of that story, that statement of what Jesus is saying is that the church where Jesus was speaking to had geothermal hot springs. They had hot water naturally flowing out of the ground. And the hot water served medicinal purposes and all sorts of different uses. And the cold water that was natural springs served all sorts of different purposes and reasons. But you see, that lukewarm water, that stagnant, that stale water never did anything but get stagnant. And Jesus says, I'd rather find that you're all the way. Because he says, if I find that you're lukewarm, stagnant and stale, talking a little bit of talk, walking a little bit, or acting a little bit of act. He says that I'll vomit you from my mouth because you are not who you think you are. But that doesn't have to be the answer. That doesn't have to be the judgment and the harshness that we look at and we realize, because you see, God gave us the answer to our lives, the solution to our needs, Jesus. The Bible says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. See, so the only thing that you and I can do is to accept this gift. It's not about your way or my way. Man, if it was about how good we could be, why would God have to send his son Jesus to die on a cross? But he did. To die for you and to die for me, for my sin, for your sin and our shame, so that we could be reunited and connected to God through Jesus. No longer on the outside, but now going on the inside. Citizens of heaven. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. God's not going to force his way or make his way or crowd his way into your life. The only thing he's going to do is give you the opportunity to accept that gift. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together just like that, real loud. And when I smack my hands together, bang, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're making a proclamation. You're making a decision today. You're deciding, you know what? I want to follow Jesus. I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I want to live according to God. You see, many of you in this place today, you're acting, you're playing, you've come in, you're doing the confession, the profession thing, and you're playing the part, but on the inside, you know that there's an emptiness. An emptiness that no matter how many relationships you try to have, you cannot fill. No matter how many things you acquire, you cannot fill. Why? Because it's a void on the inside of you that's only can be filled by God through Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life. Have it more abundantly. It's time for us to stop living life our way, because this life isn't about you. This life isn't about me. This life is about Jesus. And when we live a life for Jesus, we live life to its fullest. And we begin to see all of God's goodness in our life. And it's not even so much of what happens when we die. That's our homeland. But this journey doesn't have to be a hard wasteland that we travel through. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and have it abundantly here. It starts by accepting that gift. See, why do I have to raise my hand, Pastor Luke? I'll be embarrassed if I raise my hand. Because Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. But if you deny him, he says, I'll deny you. The decision is totally yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. It's your choice today. And I want to encourage you when that time comes to make the decision, the wise and right decision in your life, to choose life today. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ? You never started walking that walk. Today is the best day to start that race. Who should raise your hands? You're not sure. Maybe you did this as a child in the youth group. Maybe you went to one of Greg Laurie's Harvest Crusades. So wonderful that we have those things in our area, but you prayed that prayer, but you know, you never really followed through with it. You never really acted on that. You say, man, I feel like I'm the same as I was. Listen, that doesn't have to be you, because that's not what God wants you to be. Maybe you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, in church, out of church, a little bit here, a little bit there. Listen, today's a day for you to start walking the walk that God has for you, so that you can know who you are in God, so that you can know why you live here on earth, so that you can know what to do to live as a representative of Jesus Christ, because you have what the world needs through Jesus, and you can have that today. I want to give you that opportunity. So when I count to three all across this auditorium, from side to side, front to back, even the guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the glass. If you're at home watching online by the live stream, or you're even watching on our televisions around our closed circuit television around the campus, wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time. Don't waste another minute. You've had doctors and dentist appointments today. It's a divine appointment between you and God. This is your moment, the day of your salvation, the day you begin to walk that walk and not just talk the talk or act the part, but to live it on the inside, to be a part of something greater than just you, because that's what your life has been longing for altogether. So when I count to three, if that's you in this place today, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. You ready? I'm going to count. When I do, if that's you, this is your moment. This is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I got you back there. Eight wise people. Anybody on this section over here? I see the ushers pointing. Eight wise people. All right, I got you guys back there in the back. Nine. I got you right here, my man. I got you right there. 10, I got you back over there. Back in the family rooms, I see you over there. Anybody else in this place to say, man, I wonder if I should. I see you right there. I got your hand. Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on, if that's you in this place today. The Bible says it's the goodness of God. God is speaking to you right now, saying, come on, child, it's time for you to start living life. Anybody else in this place today, say, man, I wonder if I should. Multiple hands have gone up in this place, and I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. It's your call, your time. Anybody else today? I'm going to conclude right now. Got you. Right on, my man. Anybody else today? Anybody else in this place? Well, praise God. I think there's about 12, 13, 14 wise people. Awesome. There are some of you in this place where you didn't raise your hand, but you're thinking, oh man, that's me. I just didn't do it. I missed it. In just a moment, here's what we're going to do. For those of you that raise your hand, you're making a decision. We talked about this today. Remember that I made a decision to cut the cord. Making a decision doesn't do anything. Acting on it does. You made the decision to follow Jesus, and now you're proclaiming that. Now let's act on it together. We're going to do it together right here, right now. So if you raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you should have raised your hand, it's okay. It's not too late for you. In a moment, we're all going to stand up, and as we do, Elijah's going to sing a song. And for those of you that raise your hand, you're making that commitment, you're making that decision, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend, a family member, somebody with you, grab somebody and say, come with me, or grab somebody and say, come on, I'll go with you, and get out of your seat and come meet me here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand. If you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, come and meet me right here. Let's change destinies right now. This is your time. Come on, you come.
And I love you with all my soul, Lord. And I love you with
wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time.
With all that is within me. And I'll sing because you saved my soul. Downward.
praise God. You guys came. You know what? You may never had anybody tell you in your life this, but I'm going to tell you today. Good job. Good job. You're making the best decision you could possibly make. And even though you might be coming from a life full of mistakes and regret right now, good job. Good job. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. You're going to get born again. Right now, your homeland, heaven. Oh my goodness, they are having a party for you. Congratulations. This is what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy. He's going to do a couple things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on, I promise. Okay, I'll tell you what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer first and foremost. Because you don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you invited Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. You're inviting him into your life. Lord and Savior, what does that mean? We don't talk like that very often anymore. To be the leader of your life, you're going to give your life to him. Secondly, we want to leave you. We don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want to hook you up because you're starting this journey. You're starting this travel that we're talking about to the homeland, and we want you to start that journey on the right foot. So we're going to give you some free information, real easy reading, real easy literature to help you get started on the right foot. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to give you a friend. We give away friends here at the church. Somebody that will meet with you here at the church right before church service to buy a cup of coffee, get you soda. We're not asking you to join a program or anything like that. Just sit with a friend for a couple of minutes. Why? Because they're going to teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God. Because you don't want to be like Brad talking about getting strong. You want to look like Curtis, the other guy, strong. And they're going to help you do that by working at it, by walking in it. So he's going to invite you to do that. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.